Hi everyone, my name is Niladri Das. I am the founding director of Nil Advantage Technologies Private Limited. We provide IT infrastructure products and services to startups, mid-size as well as large enterprises. Today the topic before us is specifically related to a particular domain, that is a life science domain or the healthcare domain. And during this pandemic we have seen the entire change. There is a lot of change which has happened in terms of people working out from their home, and so there are multiple concerns which has come up over cloud security. Earlier, when employees were there in the organizations, in the offices, the work culture, the working pattern of these companies and working pattern of the employees were completely different. Now the working pattern has completely shifted and it has moved, it has changed a lot, which brings us to only one concern, that is how the security of the data of a company, which might be confidential to that company, how is it protected and who are the key players who help the company data protected. And specifically today I am talking about life science domain, and that is the healthcare domain or clinical research domain. And I have expert industry expert with me today who has almost 17 years of industry experience in the life science domain, in terms of the clinical data, in terms of the life science, in terms of how to protect the customer's data, and lot of discussions on today's video. So I would quickly ask a few of the questions to our subject matter experts who would like to be anonymous at this point of time, but yes, of course, he, with a lot of expertise what he has, I am sure that he would be able to answer the question. So today the agenda would be the human subject and the data protection, and what is IT infrastructure role about it, and how cloud security can help the organizations protect their confidential and very valuable data. So over to you, sir. I would thank you for being a part of this discussion. So if you can please elaborate about this particular subject of the life science domain, and how exactly this domain helps you or the cloud security has helped this particular domain to secure the data. It would be really helpful if you can give your inputs on that.
Yeah, sure, Nilabhi. Thank you for inviting me to the talk. It is wonderful that your organization is looking at focusing on a concern, something related to data security, which is also the need of the hour because of what we saw in the last 1 year. Yes. The importance of people using cloud and people going remote and every other aspect which is getting onto the cloud, and security, business continuity is something which is the focus now. I'll share my thoughts on this with respect to the life science clinical healthcare domain. As I have been in the industry since many years, one thing which there is always which goes hand in hand is data and technology. So right now what we rightly say, data is the new oil. So that's how we perceive data to be. Data has kind of got into the limelight, and the importance of it is something which is seen now. So in any human perspective, for any drug to come into the market, there has to be certain amount of testing, or what you call it as clinical trials, which has to be run. And what we could see is it all started off with paper data which were written, and then there were instances wherein doctors used to misuse it and try to have their own data fudging, etc., happening. And slowly the industry grew. We have a lot of pharma companies currently invested in such clinical trials. and trying to give an overview of what exactly would be the you know, the impact of any such wrongdoing in our arena. So data breaches related to pharma companies, etc., at least coming to the US perspective, it cost US pharma business an average of $9.5 million a year.
So that's big amount.
Yeah. So well above the national average of $3.92 million. So there is always that anybody would serious, you know, lead to serious operational disruption. Then the team will have to kind of work on reclaiming the stolen data, eliminate any risks and vulnerabilities. So that will end up protecting the company's revenues, profits and reputation. So access to this free-flowing data is one of the greatest strengths of any pharma, since it enables manufacturers to be leaner, more competitive and diversify into new products and market. Real-time data insights generated with using certain softwares gives them a dynamic view of resources and scheduling so that they can optimize every process in the business. But the more data a company holds, the greater the risk of, you know, breaching.
Right.
If it is not handled responsibly.
Right.
So you might have seen at least certain ransomware risks which has happened at least in the last 2 years.
Yes.
And especially related to hospitals, where in one of the I think a research institute or a hospital were kind of held you know, captive through the ransomware request.
Right.
The entire data related to hospital had to be. So such cases, what happens is, if you have a business continuity plan in place and you have all the data stored somewhere else which you could access, then probably you know, that is one way of dealing with it.
Right.
The other thing is, if you had a risk averse perspective and then you had seen that the entire concept was more foolproof, then you could have actually averted the entire situation.
Right.
So that is how we need to actually look at people having you know, having this data concept.
One question comes to my mind now. So in the specific your domain, that is the life science domain, so is there any guidelines or is there any regulators who kind of guide you or kind of restrict you in your data protection policies and rules?
Yes, that's a good question. In fact, how financial data is kind of controlled by RBI in Indian perspective,
right? Yes, yes.
Similarly, there are both national as well as international bodies which try to protect their interests and the human interest as well, because as you see, I mean, everything is happening right now is trying to protect human interest, right? Even from the solar system signals coming in, what should we do, the entire race to survive, etc. So if something goes wrong and impacts the human race as such, that will be the biggest loss for any you know, anybody. I mean, the whole that's all we are there for. So there are country-wide, country-specific regulatory bodies. It could be FDA in the US, DCGI in India, ANVISA in the Brazil region, then EMA in the European Union. So these are the country-specific regulatory bodies which says that you should give the data. For example, the COVID trials has to get approved by, if it has to be rolled out in the US, it has to be approved by the FDA.
Okay.
And they have to, these specific pharma companies have to submit the trial data to the FDA and then say, hey, this is what we have done, this is what the risks which we see in using the vaccine, and it might not create any death or any big risk for the human body.
Okay.
So it is safe too. So they do a lot of safety tests.
Okay.
Efficacy related tests and ensure that it is safe to be used on human. And once it is approved, it gets into the market.
Right.
So apart from their approval, during the trial phase, all these pharma companies have formed a consortium. Most of the pharma companies have formed a consortium known as ICH. They have GXP, that is good clinical practice, good manufacturing practice, all these are in place. So this ICH basically stands for International Conference on Harmonization of Technical Requirements for Registration of Pharmaceuticals for Human Use. So it consists of representatives from different bodies who come together and have formed set of guidelines. How do we have to use it?
Right.
How do the clinical trial has to run? What is of prime importance?
Okay.
All these. So for clinical domain, it's the good clinical practice is what we call. Same thing is there in terms of manufacturing the drug, so that is good manufacturing practice. So everywhere data security is of utmost importance. Right from doing this clinical trial in phases, data must be secure. We have moved all the way from so-called paper data entry to something which is all automated, and to a certain extent in terms of the softwares, it should be available at clinical sites. They recruit human subjects and then ensure that the data is kind of captured. So why it is important to capture or secure the data at that data capturing level? Because anybody who is coming into the trial might or might not be interested in revealing his information.
Okay.
Because one is, if he sees something it is related to psychiatry and he enters into this trial and the world gets to know that, hey, XYZ person is getting into a psychiatric trial.
Okay.
There could be many things. One is the trial has been tested, so things might go wrong or right.
Yes.
There is always that probability.
Yes. Yes.
Second thing is the amount of societal stigma he has to undergo, because the world might not know that he has some issue related to, you know, his own psychiatric behavior.
Right.
So both in terms of his personal life, professional life, all this creates a negative impact, which is huge.
Right.
And the whole ICH-GCP feels that we shouldn't allow any such things to happen.
Okay.
So with all these considerations, there were several CURES Act was there, all these different acts gave birth to this ICH-GCP, and even now the ICH-GCP is kind of getting reviewed every now and then. We have addendums coming, happening every now and then, especially with reference to the risk methodology, quality related methodologies, lot of digital data, whatever we call it as digital transformation coming in,
right.
A lot of digital data through IoTs and wearables coming in, so, and social media data, real world data, so how do we handle it? So a lot of work is going on behind the scene to ensure that there is enough protection for the human data which has been use.
Okay.
21 CFR Part 11 is one such guideline from the US which basically talks about Code of Federal Regulation Chapter 21 Part 11, which talks about how we use the software systems, digital electronic signature to handling electronic signatures, how paper signatures is kind of perceived as important, and how electronic signatures is also equal to paper signatures. What are the protectionist measures which we should put in place to ensure? So these are the things which industry is trying its best to put controls in place.
Okay.
So
mostly you are saying that the confidentiality of the subject or maybe the in the trials, it has to be maintained in the people level and in the technology level and in the infrastructure level also. So these are the three basic risks which are involved in this while performing these clinical trials and with all these ICH and GCP guidelines. So that has to be followed properly. So we understood in that. And we also understood that the evolution of IT infrastructure, how it started with paper-based activity, and you have correctly said that when it is a paper-based activity, there is always a chance of giving a biased response on that particular or maybe kind of tampering or modifying that particular data if it is a paper based. And with the IoT, the age where the IoT and all the devices are connected, and there are a lot of activities which are going with the help of the devices or with the handhelds or so obviously the data transfer which keeps happening in between these devices are huge. And when the data transfer is automated and it happens on a real-time basis with connecting multiple devices in medical or healthcare domain specifically, definitely there is a threat of the transfer of the data which keeps happening. So and again on top of that, the workforce is remote in this time now. So then again it comes that how the workforce is connected to the main repository of the data and how they access the data. So I'm sure there are a lot of challenges which you might be facing. So I mean, leaving this, I think there are many other things also which is there as an IT infrastructure is concerned. I mean, I'm talking about my experience about other industries as well. So typically what happens when there is a company which is there on premises, that means the company, all the employees are working into an organization. So typically the company has around let's suppose 100 people or workforce in different verticals, different fields. So they come to the office. So usually what happens is they connect their devices to the Wi-Fi or the wired network. And so the wireless devices get connected to a switch and again it goes connects to the firewall. So firewall is one of the basic kind of bridge, I mean basic kind of device which helps the entire organization using internet by not allowing multiple applications to move out or move in. And not only the applications, firewall has multiple features like intrusion prevention, anti-theft and anti-hacking. So a lot of features are there in a physical firewall. And again, yes, there are different policy based setup which has been done through the help of the firewall for the employees. Basically the password protection or anti-spyware or anti-malware or anti-bot. So basically these are the features which are there inbuilt in the firewalls which help the organization to protect the data of their employees this thing. And there is again there is something called policy based password protection. That means if a specific group of people or let's suppose the sales people in the organization, they should not be able to access the admins or the HR documents. So and vice versa. So there are many such things which keeps these policies are basically, it used to get set by the admins of firewall who were kind of securing the firewall. So it was like a server level security or perimeter level security which was happening. Then there is something called identity theft. Basically, if there is the password of one person is known to the other person and how and he somehow impersonates that he is that person and he gives the same password and logs into the system. So so there is definitely there is a risk of having an identity theft. These are many such risks involved in a conventional setup. Now that is not there anymore. So now the people are remotely working. Nobody is coming to office nowadays. But yes, of course, there will be a time when people will be again coming back. But again, the now this entire on-prem setup has moved to the cloud now. So in the cloud, so that means the people are remotely getting connected to their applications. People are remotely using their servers. People are remotely accessing the client information or the subject information. So when the cloud concept has come, so there are many questions also comes to our mind. So how the seamless connectivity will be there, how the people will access remotely, how the users will access remotely, and what will be the scalability or elasticity, and what would be the on-demand computing? That means if there is a specific instance or a server which is there running now, and there is all of a sudden there is a demand of the users to install one more server, so can it be done on a real time in the cloud? So that those things are also happening now, and it is possible nowadays. So adoption of cloud has changed the complete on-premise setup into the cloud, and again the users are always benefited, where if there is a it is like paper use model. So the moment they they need one more server, they can put one more. If they need some applications to be added, they will just pay for those applications. The moment they don't want it, they can stop it. So these are some of the benefits of adopting to the cloud. But I have also seen with this age, so there are many customers also who are moving back from the cloud because of the cost factor and because of the data security. So I am sure that there are many risks also involved when people move to cloud. So let me elaborate that in a structured way. So the security concern, the moment the people have moved from the office to their homes, respective homes and hometowns, and they have started using their personal laptop or the laptops or desktops or the devices which have been given by the organization. So there is definitely a security risk on the device, because companies might have some antivirus in that, but it is not properly monitored, or there is no policy, proper policy which might have been set up in that laptop. So that is number one. Number two is that the employee might have those endpoints with them, but still they might be using some data or might be connected to the server remotely situated in some other location, and there is a possibility that the attacker might get into the system through the help of this remote workforce. So that is again one more issue. The third issue, which is like, again it comes back to your industry guidelines, that is like, is there any data compliance which the person has, because the person who is or the employee who is outside of your perimeter firewall, he is connected to the server, or he is connected to the client's data center. So how and he is using the data, he is accessing the data. So how is that person, in case if anything or the person thinks of doing something mischievous, so how can that be stopped? How can that be flagged? So those things are the thing which we should also take into consideration. And yes, again, the impact of all these risks involved in the remote workforce, or so it has a huge impact on the life science domain, specifically your domain. So now I would like to say that since I have understood the concept of your particular domain, and as an organization, Nil Advantage Technologies, we offer, our core strength is the networking and security. So mostly we have tie-ups with multiple OEMs. When I say OEM, means there are many examples of such companies, like we are a partner for Cisco, we are a partner for Checkpoint, we are a partner for various other companies like Fortinet, we are a partner for HPE, and so the various companies have different kinds of such security solution which they offer along with their product. There are many products which are kind of a cloud product, there are many products which are on-premise product. So now there is something called data loss prevention also, which is like mostly all these users, all the IT users, or all the users who are there in your domain, or when they work remotely, so the data, they definitely access the data. So how to prevent the loss of those data, basically? So there is something called, there are many such organizations, many companies who have a very unique offerings with respect to this. typically one example I'll give you. There is a company who has a, if suppose there is a particular file which has a, which is a confidential file, and the confidential file is accessed from the remote server which is situated in the cloud, and I'm giving you a typical example. So, and that particular file has been downloaded by X person remotely at some low remote location, and so the moment the movement of this data happens from the cloud to this particular person's endpoint or the laptop, and then that particular person might transfer that particular information to somebody which is unsolicited. So those trial or those audit can be done where you can see from where the data came and where it got went off, and even if it goes in an email communication or in any format, if that file name has also been changed. So those things, those audit trials can be done, the forensics can be done using, there are different technologies which can be done, and it can be found out whether and it can also be some certain point of time it can be remotely deleted also. So there are certain companies who also do that, and we are proudly associated with those companies where we have done this implementations for those companies, where we have remotely connected the entire IT users of the company who are remotely working, and we have also given them a VPN connectivity, and where there are multiple sites which we have connected through the VPN tunneling, and all the remote workforce will be connected to one site, and they will the entire traffic or entire data would take through different routes, and they will access their clients' information from the servers which are situated in different countries. So we have done all this. These are our expertise. We would look forward to work with you, and I'm sure that I am not pulling this topic too long. So I would just like to close this discussion, and there are, yes, again, of course, there are many products in the market. Usually the CISOs or the chief technology officers, they get confused seeing which product they should go for. So when it comes to the antivirus or antibot or malware protection or intrusion prevention, so people get confused, and since there are multiple vendors, multiple technology companies who have their products, they have certain uniqueness in their products. They keep pitching in their product saying their product is the right product, they should go for that, which might not be the exact requirement for the customer. The person or the CTOs who are looking for some very niche product which can help in getting the job done, they need not invest a huge amount of money to kind of get into that or buy the product which is very expensive. They might also go for certain product which might be able to fulfill their requirement. So in those scenarios, we are there to help you out, and with respect to the life science, yes, we have that experience, and I am sure that you can use our experience for your benefit. And finally, sir, thank you so much. Would you like to say a few words while we are closing this discussion?
Sure, yeah. I mean, it was good knowing what is happening in terms of the technical technology forefront. And as you rightly said, there is huge risk everywhere in terms of, now, for example, Gowling's digital risk calculator highlighted that external cyber risk are the most concerning category of digital threat. And second biggest digital threat was related to sensitive and valuable data.
Right.
Other concern with the customer security, identity of theft, and insider crime from employees.
Yes.
So the whole thought of it could be business related to finance or life science. How do we protect our business? How do we ensure the identified personal information and the personal health information is kind of protected?
Right.
How do we protect the corporate confidential info? And as you said, I mean, these large companies work with a lot of vendors.
Right.
Now, how do we ensure that the vendors are protecting the data, what is being accessed by them. So there is hardware part of it, the software part of it. So what involves is continuing the business with all that in place. And in terms of the penalization, so I think you would have heard about something known as GDPR. So everybody talks about GDPR now. So there is, life science companies face significant regulatory issues if they fail to secure their data. Some businesses are unaware of the extent of the fines they would receive for failing to protect their data.
So
they'll have to, bear these things. So it's very important to have two, three things. One is awareness. So general employee security knowledge, and then the company's investment in security infrastructure.
Yes.
To ensure the risk is thwarted.
Yes.
So one is internal aspect of ensuring people are aware of it, because their own workforce, their vendors are knowledgeable.
Yes.
Second thing is the spending which has to happen on ensuring the
Absolutely.
Infra is secure has to be taken into picture. So I appreciate the steps taken by your organization in supporting the companies in such aspects, which is very critical right now.
Right.
And I wish you the good luck.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. It's nice talking to you.
Thank you.